Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Triss by Brian Jacques, narrated by the author and others. The author opens with Kruva's song.
The days that long was grass so green, in seasons of youthful desire, roaming o'er seas of aquamarine, where western suns drown in fire. Cross mountain, forest and river, I'd wander carefree and bold, never heeding the days to come, when I'd wake up slow and old. Oh, how the silent summer noon warms dusty memories in an orchard midst my dreams, neath verdant shadeful trees. Come visit me, you little ones, hear stories, songs and rhymes, a roving warrior's saga of far gone golden time.
And now, Triss.
Book One, A Season of Runaways. Chapter 1. Princess Kurda was considered by all to be a highly skilled sword beast, the best blade at Riftguard since her grandsire, great King Sarengo. She was a pure ferret, as were all of the royal blood, creamy white from tail tip to nose, with coral pink eyes. Kurda worked hard at being the best. Every morning from breakfast to lunch she could be found practicing in her weapon chamber. This particular morning was no exception. Rows of turnips hung by strings from the rafters. Two squirrel slaves, one a young maid, the other an old grizzled male, stood by awaiting her commands. The princess donned a single long-sleeved glove of ecru linen, pulling it tight on her paw. She nodded at the long rack of swords, her voice curt and imperious.
"Di heavy saber, yar!"
Triss the squirrel maid hastily wrapped an oiled rag about her paws and lifted the heavy sabre from the rack by its blade, carefully avoiding getting oil on the leather-bound hilt. Kurda flexed her limbs gracefully. Without even a glance at Triss, she grabbed the sword, drawing the blade so swift and hard from the squirrel maid's grasp that it sliced through the oiled rag and nicked her paw. Triss leaped smartly out of the way, her teeth clenched in pain, as the ferret princess went slashing at the turnips. With deadly accuracy, the heavy sabre made the air thrum, chopping through the solid vegetables. Halves of turnip flew everywhere, striking both slaves, bouncing off the floor and caroming from the walls until there was nothing left but straggled roots dangling from the strings. Kurda wiped a scrap of turnip from her cheek with the linen glove, panting slightly. Holding the sabre point forward to Triss, the ferret grated.
"Clean this good. I try rapier now, yar. The rapier."
Triss hurried to select the rapier Kurda had indicated. The old male squirrel, Drufo, scrambled to clear the floor of turnip pieces, careful to wipe any wet spots, lest the princess should slip. It would go badly for both slaves if she did, as they knew from bitter experience. Fixing her paw firmly in the basket hilt of the rapier, Kurda whipped the keen, flexible blade back and forth, enjoying the sound it made. Triss signalled Rufo with her eyes. He skirted the walls furtively until he arrived behind his young friend. diligently cleaning the sabre blade upon her oiled rag, Triss watched Kurda work with the rapier. Poising herself like a dancer, with one paw outstretched, she attacked the root stems on the string ends. Snick, whip, zip. The blade struck with swift, snake-like movements, snicking the roots off at the string, though the last two strikes missed the roots, severing the strings. Kurda snorted with anger. Dropping the sword carelessly, she rapped out more commands.
Get me the straight sword, middle size. You get ready to throw when I say. Move yourselves.
Drufo ran and picked up two of the larger chunks of cut turnip. Triss grabbed the rapier and selected the long, medium-weight straight sword with a cross-hilt and fine-honed double blade. The ferret princess snatched it impatiently from her, whirling the blade and shouting at Drufo.
Throw! Throw!
Throwing both pieces of turnip upward, Drufo covered his head with both paws, jumping out of the way. Kurda slashed up, then sideways, in two speedy movements. She cut one piece, but the other thudded to the ground untouched. Kurda's pink eyes blazed with anger at her error. Drufo was bending to pick up the pieces when she whipped the flat of the blade viciously across his back.
Stupid off! When I say throw, you throw them proper. Throw high! What do you think I am, you thick, mad brain bungle bores?
Drufo stayed bent over, still protecting his head with both paws, as the ferret vented her spleen on him with the flat of the sword blade. Knowing her old friend was in danger of losing his life, Triss yelled as she began throwing turnip chunks in the air with all the haste she could muster.
Princess, I can throw better than that old fool. Look, hup, hup, I can send them higher too. Ready, throw!
The ploy diverted Kurda's attention. She turned and chopped both chunks as they came down. The squirrel maid, who was ready with two more, made sure she tossed them high and slow. The sword cut through the chunks easily. Kurda was out of breath, but her temper had improved. She leaned on the sword, nodding and panting.
You throw good. That's the way to throw turnips. Yar.
The door opened, and another pure ferret ambled in. He was bigger than his sister and had a silly grin all over his face. Kurda addressed her brother contemptuously.
What do you want, Blad Bootnose?
Blad was used to his sister's insulting manner. His droopy, oversized gut wobbled as he chuckled.
Ha ha ha! You make a better cook than a sword beast, yeah? You still chopping turnips for the stew, little sister? Ha ha ha!
She raised the sword, advancing on him.
One day I chop you for the stew, lard barrel. Yar, I chop you. Good. Why you come here, eh?
Blad shuffled to the door and held it half open, creating a shield between them. He poked his tongue childishly at Kurda.
King want to see you, yar. He mad about the herrings. He say come now, quick, or he put a big lock on his door.
Kurda pointed at him with the sword, her bad mood renewed.
Sneak nose! You've been telling tales to King about me!
Blad took off downstairs, laughing idiotically, with his sister hard on his heels. Triss helped Drufo up as the door slammed behind the two pure ferrets. She steadied the old squirrel.
Are you all right, Drufo? She didn't cut you, did she?
He smiled, rubbing his back ruefully.
Thanks to you, she didn't, missy. Thanks to you! So beast! That white streak of slime ain't half the sword beast your dad was. White streak of slime.
Triss chuckled silently at the way her old friend often repeated phrases. She set about gathering up the cut turnips.
Lend a paw with these, you old grumbler. Let's get them out to the others. Every bit helps.
The squirrel maid poked her head over the sill of the high chamber window and imitated the harsh shrike of a seagull. Far below, a gang of creatures were working, laying a path of pine logs to make a walkway between the sloping grass hill and the rocky shore of the river. It would run from the gates of Riftguard Fortress along its edge to the jetty. Moored at the pier's end, facing downriver to the sea, was a ship. It was small, with one square purple sail, a very pretty little craft, skillfully built and wonderfully ornamented. The workers, an assortment of squirrels, mice, hedgehogs and otters, looked upward at the window. A slim, pretty sea otter maid named Sleeve murmured,
"Stand aside, mates. Here comes supper, thanks to Miss Triss."
As they dropped the turnips down, Triss questioned Rufo about her father, whom she had never known.
Do you remember my father? What was he like, Rufo?
The old squirrel shook his head fondly. Oh,
like no other, young un, like no other. There was never a sword beast born could cross blades with Rock Arum. And I knows, cause I fought alongside him. We was like brothers.
Triss heaved more turnips over the sill to her friends below.
But despite all that, he was slain.
Trufo paused for a moment, his face grim.
Brought him down with arrows, more than a score of those dirty Riftguard rats. I remembers it to this day. But Rock, your pa, went down fighting, snapped his blade and hurled it in their faces. Rock Arum wasn't never one to surrender. Never.
Triss sighed as she swept the last vegetables up from the floor.
Wish I'd have been old enough to fight. They'd have never got him. We'd have still been free, living in the mountains upriver, all of us.
Trufo watched those below gathering the last of the turnips. He looked to the high mountains on either side of the river, thick pine woods sweeping down their sides to the rocky banks, still patched with last winter's heavy snows. The old squirrel voiced his thoughts.
"'Tis a cold, hard place to live, this Northland, I tell ye. And a harder place to be enslaved in than any I know."
Keeping her voice low, the squirrel maid drew close to Rufo.
"Once we've got the boat built, it'll be down river in the open seas for us. We'll find a better life in those lands beyond the great sea."
Rufo grabbed her paw anxiously.
"Triss, don't be foolish. No beast ever escaped from Riftguard and lived to tell of it. You've got to forget those mad ideas."
Triss pulled her paw from his grasp.
4 more days, that's all it'll take, Rufo. I'm not missing a chance of freedom by being faint-hearted. Shogg the otter and Welfo the hedgehog have been helping me. Our boat should be ready soon. You can escape with us. There's room for one more."
Trufo looked at Triss anxiously, keeping his voice low.
"You three don't know the danger you're in, missy. You just don't know. Stealing wood from the king's new walkway, piling up victuals and tacking together rags for a sail. Ah, 'tis too risky. I want no part of it. No part, you hear me? I ain't going to be responsible for the death of young creatures."
Triss cocked an ear to a sound outside on the stairway. She muttered swiftly under her breath.
"Stow it. Some beast's coming."
The door was wrenched suddenly open. Captain Rifton and 4 of his rats marched into the chamber. Triss and Rufo fell upon all fours, making a pretense of cleaning the floor. Rifton was a mean-natured rat. Cruelty was stamped on his narrow face. He leaned on his spear and placed a footpaw hard on the back of Triss's neck.
"So tell me, what are slaves doing alone and unattended in a room full of weapons, eh?"
Trufo kept his tone humble as he explained.
"Princess Kurda gave us permission, Captain. We've been attending her at sword practice. Me and Triss is just cleaning up. We're near done, Captain."
The rat captain glanced round the chamber.
"Looks clean enough to me, eh, lads?"
The 4 rat guards nodded their agreement eagerly.
"Aye, Captain."
Rifton lashed out with his spear haft, knocking Trufo flat.
"Don't ever let me catch you alone in here again. Get down to the walkway and report for work. On the double!"
Trufo scrambled up and made for the door. Triss was about to rise and go with him when Rifton brought his spear point down to rest at the base of her skull.
"Not you. I've had you watched, missy. You're going down in the cages to keep your 2 little pals, the otter and the spike pig, company. Bet you thought I didn't know you was making an escape boat. Take her, guards!"
2 rat guards grabbed Triss's paws, whilst the other 2 menaced her with their spears. Trufo tried to intercede.
"But, Captain, it couldn't have been her. She's been with me all the time for days now. Triss ain't done nothing, I swear it."
Rifton gave him a kick that sent him staggering awkwardly down the stairs. He winked at the 4 guards.
"Show me a slave and I'll show you a liar. Take her to the cages. She'll sing like a lark when I'm done with her."
Triss was hauled off downstairs, tight-lipped but struggling. She glimpsed Trufo's pitiful, frightened face as they dragged her off to the punishment cages. Thank you. Chapter 2. Beyond the trackless seas, far from the fjords and mountains of Riftgard, the late spring afternoon was mellow as butter and blue as a periwinkle. Great Abbot Apodemus and his old companion, Malbon Grimp, sat dozing peacefully on the sun-warmed ramparts of Redwall Abbey's northeast wall. Somewhere over the treetops of Mossflower, a blackbird warbled its rich, fruity aria to the season. There was hardly a breeze to be felt. Down below, the abbey grounds basked, still and silent in serene noontide. Malbon was a woodmouse who held the position of healer and recorder of Redwall. She was drifting off into a slumber, both eyelids drooping as her chin dropped toward her chest. An admiral butterfly ventured to perch on Malbon's nose. She banished it with a twitch of her snout and opened one eye.
Any sign of them coming back yet, Ap?
Apodemus had his eyes closed, but he was not yet asleep.
I dunno. Why don't you go and look, Mal?
Malbon opened her other eye, turning her gaze upon the yellow-necked mouse who was Father Abbot of all Redwall.
"'Cause I'm only a lonely beast around here. You're the abbot. They're your responsibility.'
Apodemus kept his eyes closed, relishing the warmth of the sun upon his ears.
"'Tis a powerful position, being abbot of Redwall Abbey.'
Malbon considered this statement before replying.
"'Aye, so it is.'
A slow smile broke the repose of Apodemus's features.
"'Well, I'm glad you realise that, Mal. I order you to go and look to see if the Whortleberry gathering party are returning.'
With a sigh, the healer recorder pushed herself upright, smiling as she shuffled to the battlements.
"'That's a flagrant abuse of power, Father Abbot. I'll do your bidding, but I'd like it noted. I'm doing it under protest.'
The abbot opened his eyes and winked at his companion.
"'Protest noted. Now go and look, will you?'
Turning her back, Malbon leaned against the battlement.
"'Don't have to look. I can hear them. Listen!'
Carrying over the still air, voices could be heard raised in song, young and old alike.
All in the days of spring, when flowers do bloom about, we merrily go and sing, ho, ho, whortleberries come out. Whortleberry, blyberry, bilberry too. They taste so good to me, my friend, as they must do to you. And yet I say to you now, oh, what is in a name? For whortle, bill, or blyser, the berry's all the same. We range the forest far, for there's no beast will deny. Naught is half so good, ho, ho, as whortleberry pie. Pill, whortle, bly, bly, whortle, bill. All around the woodlands, field or valley or hill. Get ready, good old cook, marm, stoke up your oven's fire. A whortleberry pie this eve is my dear heart's desire.
Apodemus rose and stretched lazily.
We'd best go down and open the gate if we want any pie for supper. Come on, I'll race you.
Malbon Grimp's huge middle shook with laughter.
Are you talking to me or that snail just by your footpaw? Race me, indeed. We'll soon need a hoist to get us up and down the wall stairs.
The abbot gazed ruefully at his considerable stomach.
Oh, for the days when we were dibbons.
The two old friends linked paws and shuffled off down the broad red sandstone wall steps, chunnering away to one another.
I'll wager that snail would have beaten you easily.
Ah, you're right, Mal. We're built for comfort, not speed.
Right. And we've got the dignity of our positions to consider. Wouldn't look right a Father Abbot and a healer recorder charging about like two frantic frogs.
Wandering between vegetable patches and around through the orchard, they came out onto the front lawns. Late daffodils, blue milkwort, buttercup and pink speedwell bordered the soft green grass. Behind them, as they made their way down the gravelled path to the main gate, Redwall Abbey reared high in dusty rose-hued splendour. Arches, buttresses, bell tower, carved gables, and long stained glass windows sat square in the centre of abbey grounds and stout outer walls. Apodemus stopped a moment, turning to cast a fond eye over the ancient structure, then gripped his friend's paw a little firmer and sighed.
I love our abbey, Mal. Sometimes I get up early just to look at it in dawn's light. There's no place like it, is there?
Malbon patted his paw fondly.
No place at all, Ap. We're lucky to be living here. Very lucky.
Between them, the two mice lifted the wooden gate lock bar amid ribald calls outside from the Redwallers.
Open up, or we'll scuff all these berries.
Quick, before we starve to death.
You never starving to death with your gird stomach like that, honey, sir.
Take a look at yourself, old fatty chops.
The huge oaken doors swung open. Apodemus and Malbon jumped smartly aside as the abbey creatures poured in. Squirrels, mice, moles, hedgehogs, some shrews, three otters, even a large old female hare. All of them carried some form of basket, pail or trug, laden with ripe whortleberries. Abbey babes, or dibbons as they were called, had their paws and faces liberally stained with the purplish-blue juice. The abbot shook his head in mock severity at a mole child, who was stained from top to tail.
Deary me, Master Ruggum. You look as if you've had a busy day.
Ruggum explained in curious mole speech.
We were doing girtly well, sir, till he rascal Bickle pushed oi into wee basket of berries, but oi etted my way out of them.
Bickle, a tiny squirrel with a huge bushy tail, tried hard to look the picture of innocence as she defended herself.
Father Habit, Ruggum pulled me tail, so I chased him and he fell into the berries herself by Askedent.
Apodemus could not hide a smile as he replied.
By Askedent? Goodness me, that Ruggum's always having Askedents. What do you say, Mem Flackery?
The fat old female hare, who was nurse to all the Dibbons, pulled off a poke bonnet and fanned her whiskers with it.
Fiends, marauders, all of them, what? Into the tub with a bloomin' lot of you, that's what I'd jolly well say.
Yells of dismay arose from the Dibbons.
Wah! Not more tubs, ma'am. I's only got bath last night.
We'll be scrubbed to wee shadow if a new and put oi in ee tub again, ma'am. Bain't that right, Turfy?
Turfy, the mouse babe, scowled darkly.
They scrubs licklins to death in this habby.
Girdle Sprink, the hedgehog cellar keeper, eyed Turfy sternly.
You mind your manners, young'un. A bath'll do ye the world of good, then off to bed with the lot of ye.
A horrified silence fell over the Dibbon contingent. Then Ruggum raised a small clenched paw and shouted,
Dab!
Immediately, the little creatures scattered, all yelling,
Dab! 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 Dab!
Mem Flackery grabbed the two nearest her to stop them escaping.
I say, some beast close the flipping gate, sharpish!
Skipper of Otters was lithe and brawny. He swiftly closed the gates and dropped the gate lock shut. Catching a hog babe by her apron strings, he shook his rudder-like tail in puzzlement.
Dab? What's Dab supposed to mean, mate?
Crickolus, the ancient shrew gatekeeper, explained.
It's old little scamp's latest secret society. Dibbons against bedtime. That's what Dab means. They don't like being sent off to the dormitories early. Oh, I'll never join them. I loves me bed. I'd stay there all season if I could.
After a deal of chasing, the Dibbons were rounded up and herded inside the abbey. Mem and Friar Gooch, the abbey squirrel cook, followed them in.
Think I'll preserve some of those berries in honey.
Mem tried not to look crestfallen.
Not all of them, Friar. You are going to cook some tonight.
Friar Gook patted a paw.
Don't fret yourself, Marm. I've planned some whortleberry sponge puddings with cream and crumble topping.
The fat hair nurse's eyes lit up greedily.
Oh, my aunt's whiskers, you're a bloomin' toff, Gooch. An absolutely first-rate grub slinger, what?
Beyond the locked abbey gates, Ruggum the mole babe and Bickle the little squirrel sat on the path giggling. They had evaded capture by nipping out a second before Skipper shut the doors.
Skipper amongst chap my tail laughing in yon doors. Oi bees most speedy for a mole child.
Bickle whirled a bushy tail in delight.
As well get that and send it to bed early. No more.
Ruggum sucked juice from a berry he found on the path.
Burbick, we am sure to get captured if an us be stepping out yer. He mem bees awful fast for a girt fatty beast.
Bickle did not hesitate. She grabbed her friend's paw resolutely.
Come on, as run away and live in the woods, Ruggs.
Ruggan brightened up at the thought of this capital scheme.
You're right, Bick. They ain't gonna keep baffing us and sending us out to bed early till we am old and dead and buried.
Paw in paw, the two Dimbons trundled off north up the path, cutting off east into mossflower woodlands and making plans for the marvellous life that lay ahead of them.
We live up in a tree and eat apples and anything.
Oi, okie us will, and never get a bath or even a little wash.
And just play and play all day and all night long.
Brr, them biggins be very sad as and's gannered.
Tja, now they have to bath each other and go to beds early. That teach them a lesson.
Spring eventide threaded crimson, gold and lavender rays through the leafy woodland canopy. Day's last long shadows darkened Redwall's lawns, shading the grass to a rich emerald carpet. Single notes and trills of nightingales echoed from the abbey orchard, serenading the coming darkness. Gooch and his trusty assistant cook, a young mole maid named Fuddle, checked the rows of earthenware basins as they loaded up trolleys in the kitchens. Both were satisfied that the whortleberry puddings were perfect in every respect. Formole, Redwall's traditional mole leader, stood by his trolley, button nose a-quiver at the delicious aroma from the basins. Fuddle chuckled at the look of bliss upon his face.
Your uncle, I'll help you load your trolley afore your snout be fallen off in delight.
Formole patted his niece's paw fondly.
You're my good and kindly mole furl. Thank you, Gertie, my dearie.
Redwall had two dining rooms. The Great Hall, which is used for large feasts or special occasions, and Cavern Hall, a smaller, more comfortable chamber. Abbot Appademus took his seat in Cavern Hall alongside Girdle Spring. Rubbing his paws in anticipation, the cellar hog remarked,
I'll wager in less a score of days 'twill be light and warm enough to take our evening meals out in the orchard.
Appademus watched Redwallers seating themselves.
Aye, summer will soon be upon us, Girdle. Oh, look out, here comes trouble. But don't they look nice and clean?
Straight from the bathtubs, a horde of Dibbons in clean smocks came dashing in to claim their favourite places at table. Mem, Sister Vernal and Malbon shepherded them in, issuing cautions as they tried to keep order.
Don't run. What have you been told about running, hey? Walk nice and slowly now. That includes you, Turfy.
I say go around the table, you little rip. Don't you dare try to climb over the Father Abbot.
Come here, Toobles. There's still soup in your ears. Gotcha.
The tiny hedgehog squealed outrageously as Malbon cleaned out the soap with her apron corner. Old Cricolus, the gatekeeper, covered both ears and closed his eyes tightly until peace was restored and the Dibbons seated. Abbot Appademus rose from his chair to recite a grace.
Be thankful for the season and happy for the day. Be grateful for the bounty which comes to us this way. Good food from the earth is grown and brought unto our table. By honest toil and labour, let's eat whilst we are able.
The silence was broken by Turfy the mouse babe, banging his spoon upon the table and roaring.
Where are me pudding?
Girdle Spink glared severely at the rowdy Dibbon for a moment. Then he called out.
Aye, where's that child's pudding? Bring it right away.
Amid hoots of laughter, the puddings were served. Halfway through the meal, Skipper of Otters was pouring out dandelion cordial for some of the little ones, when he glanced around and scratched his rudder.
Where's little Ruggum and Bickle? Any beast seen them?
Sister Vernal looked at Mem.
I can't recall bathing them. Can you, Mem?
Not really. I say, Malbon, old thing, did you scrub those two rascals, what?
Malbon tapped a paw against her chin thoughtfully.
No, ma'am, but I recall we had two clean smocks left over when we dressed the Dibbons. I just thought they were extras.
The abbot addressed the other Dibbons, who were spooning in whortleberry pudding and swigging cordial as if they had survived a seven-season famine.
Did any of you see Ruggum or Bickle this evening?
Formole murmured into the abbot's ear.
No use asking them infants. They're busy eating puddings.
Mem Flackery chuckled dryly.
Indeed they are, old scout. You'd get more sense out of the puddings than those ravenous scoundrels. Just look at them eat.
Gooch and Fuddle went and took a quick look around the kitchens. The two missing Dibbons were nowhere to be seen. Old Criculus shrugged his narrow shoulders.
Oh, they've probably pinched a couple of puddings for themselves and gone off to eat them without getting bathed first.
Apodemus was inclined to agree with him.
That's right. They'll turn up sooner or later. I wager they're snoozing in some quiet corner. If any beast should find them, I'd be grateful if you'd bring them both up to my room. I intend to have a severe word or two with the Master Ruggum and Miss Bickle.
Out in Mossflower Woods, darkness had descended. Moon shadows and shifting breezes created an eerie pattern through the leafy tree canopy. Somewhere, an owl hooted, and a nightjar's churring staccato rent the woodlands. Ruggum and Bickle huddled together in the shelter of a fallen beech tree. Both were cold, hungry, and frightened little creatures.
You're Bick. I'm thinking it be time to go home.
Bickle was of the same mind as her mole friend.
Me want to go home too, but men be shouting at us and send us to beds with no puddings. We still want to go home, though.
Yeah, then us'n's go right now, and you be know anyway, Bick.
I not know. You said you knowed.
Who are you, McGirt fibber? I never said I knowed anyway.
They sat looking at one another. Then chorused aloud.
We're lost.
Chapter 3. Night-dark waves lapped softly upon the western shores like a black velvet cloak, endlessly unfolding. A full, honey-dipped moon shed its light over the scene below, softening the rugged formation of the mountain fortress known as Salamandastron. Four creatures, two badgers and two hares, leaned on a smooth, wide window ledge about halfway up the mountain, watching the activity of two younger creatures below. They conversed in hushed tones. Lord Hightower, the great badger ruler, heaved a sigh of resignation.
Well, if he's got to go, then I suppose it's inevitable. Maybe out there Sir Gaxus will learn a bit of sense. I can't take much more of that young rip. It's probably all for the best. If he stays here disobeying me, we're bound to meet head-on before long. Still have my doubts about it, though.
Hightower's wife, the Lady Marola, stroked his paw soothingly.
It didn't do you much harm when you ran off for a few seasons as a young badger. You told me so yourself. Two male badgers on the same mountain would never work. Even I can see that. Poor Sir Gaxus. He's a born rebel. I can't help worrying about him. He's got a lot of hard lessons to learn out there. I do hope he'll be all right.
Colonel Whipscott of the Long Patrol was a hare of the old school. Twirling his waxed moustached whiskers, he puffed out his metal-clad chest and murmured confidently,
"All right, milady! Why shouldn't they be jolly well all right, what? Your son and my son leaving home for a blooming good adventure or two? Don't be good, I say. Keep the blighters out of our fur for a while. Do you know, it's flipping hard to tell who's the worst rascal between them, young Sir Gaxus or that mascarum of mine? Rogues, rogues and bounders, the pair of them. They won't come to much harm, believe me."
The colonel's wife, Dunfrida, interrupted him sharply.
"I should say they won't come to much harm, Whippy, because you'll be out there following them every poor step of the way."
The colonel looked slightly deflated. He began blustering.
I say, steady on there, old girl. Me following those two rips for a couple of seasons? What do you think I am, a blooming stalking duck? Out of the question, I'm afraid. I've got my command to attend to here, what?
That did it. Dunfrida whipped out a small kerchief and commenced weeping inconsolably.
You heartless hare! My poor little Bescarum and Marola's only son, wandering round the world willy-nilly like two homeless waves.
Whipscott raised his eyes in despair, apologising to Lord Hightower, as Lady Marola comforted Dunfrida.
"Beg pardon, sir. The good lady wife can't resist a jolly good blubber now and again, what? Here you are, old girl. Take my kerchief. That won't be enough to stop the tide coming in, what?"
Lord Hightower placed a paw about his friend's shoulders.
Dunfeed is right. You'd best follow them. Keep an eye on that pair. It'll only be for a season or two, but it will put all our minds at rest. I look after the mountain.
Colonel Whipscott was flabbergasted.
What? You don't really mean that.
Of course he means it, you wasky-whiskered clot. Go on, follow the two poor dears right now, this very instant. Go.
Hightower peered out the window at Sagaxus and Biscarum on the beach far below. Both were starting to head north, carrying massive backpacks of food purloined from Salomon Dastan's kitchens. The Badger Lord could not resist a chuckle.
Look at that lot they're carrying. 'Tis enough to keep a regiment going for a full season. No need to hurry, Whipscott. At the rate they're travelling, you'll pick up their trail quite easily after breakfast tomorrow morning. That's if they've left enough victuals in the kitchens for the cooks to make a meal.
Biscarum tried to set the pack more evenly between his shoulder blades, grunting with exertion.
Wait for me, Sagex, old lad. Me blinking paws are sinking in the sand with this confounded heavy pack.
Sagaxus, who liked to be called Sagax, was by far the stronger of the pair, even though he was staggering a little as he called back over his shoulder to Biscarum, who preferred the name Scarum.
Good job we don't have to walk far then, Scarum. Just round the cove to the rocks at the North Spur. Wait till Coover sees all the grub we've brought along, eh?
Scarum caught up with his badger pal.
Indeed, if we're running off to sea, then we need the proper scoff, what? Yucko! I don't mind living off the land, but that idea of Coovers of living off the sea? Raw fish and seaweed? I should jolly well say not.
They edged down below the tide line to where the sand was firmer under paw. It made the going easier. Sagax was smiling happily.
No more being sentenced to washing the pots.
Scarum grinned like a demented rabbit.
Or scrubbing the blooming mess hall out.
Or weeding the rock gardens all day.
Or polishing spears and shields in the dratted armoury.
Sagax did a fair imitation of his father.
I can understand Biscarum, he's a hare. But you, Sagaxus, you're supposed to be the son of a badger lord. Why your mother even named you Sagaxus, I'll never know. She said you were supposed to be like that old badger lord she'd read of, Rossano the Wise, her fifth great-grandsire. So she called you Sagaxus. That's supposed to mean wise also. Huh! Now this is your last chance, do you hear me?
Scarum did an even better impersonation of his father.
You're a rip, sir, an utter flipping rip, what? You see these grey hairs ruining me best moustache, eh? Well, you put them there. If you were one of my patrol, I'd clap you in the belly dungeons, what?
Kruver heard them coming. Making the bow line fast to a nubby rock, he leaped down onto the sand.
Come on, mateys, stay your stumps, or we'll miss the tide.
His boat was a double-sail ketch, which he had stolen from three sea rats a season ago. It was a trim-lined little vessel, with fore and aft sails, the latter being set slightly in front of the rudder. Kruver gasped as he helped them to heave their packs on board. He loosed the bowline as they skipped aboard.
Stamp me, rudder! You're trying to sink us with victuals!
Scarum wrinkled his nose at the sea otter.
You carry on scoffing seaweed and sprats. Leave this to us, pal.
Kruver caught the breeze just right and sent the ketch skimming on a northwesterly tack, his hearty laugh ringing out.
Ha-ha! Me old mateys! Welcome aboard the stop dog!
Sagax looked at him questioningly.
The stop dog?
Kruver winked and gave him a roguish grin.
Aye, that's the last thing I heard those three sea rats hollering after me. Stop dog! So that's what I call her, the stop dog.
Scarum tried to rise gingerly from a sitting position.
Shouldn't we be doing something? Paddling or tugging on ropes to make this boat go?
Kruver had the foresail fixed and the stern sail controlled in one paw, as he held the tiller with the other.
Bless your heart, no mate. This thing goes by herself, though it needs a expert's paw like mine to keep her on course.
Sagax watched the skillful otter intently.
How did you learn to sail like that? Did your parents teach you?
Kruver shrugged.
I never had no parents, mate. Leastways, none that I knows about. Out here on the briny, it's learn fast or perish, and I wasn't about ready to perish.
Scarum began opening one of the backpacks.
Talking about parents, I'll bet my old pa's whiskers will really curl when he finds out I've hopped it. As for Mum, she'll probably blubber till there ain't a dry kerchief on the flipping mountain. Loves a good blubber, though it drives Pa sketty, what?
Sagax felt his conscience twinging guiltily.
Let's stop talking about parents. Tain't as though we'll never see him again. We'll probably drift back to the mountain in a season or two, when we're too grown up for them to push and shove us around. Ha! Bet they'll be glad to see us then. Come on, Kruver, you old sea dog. Give us one of your ditties.
Immediately, the cheerful sea otter obliged. He had a good voice.
Oh, I was born in a storm one winter's morn, when I was fat and tiny, with the wind for me pa and the sea for a my way out upon the briny. Let the codfish sing with a ding-a-ling, and the crabs dance with the shark. Hey-ho again for the rolling main, I'm happy as a lark. Oh, my first ship was cockle shell, I painted it bright red. Oh, hey, I jitter with me tail as I rid a far o'er the waves I sped. Then a nice old whale made me a sail that helped me to go faster. So I voyaged free on the deep blue sea with no beast for a master.
The little ketch was soon lost in a world of silver-flecked water, scudding out north-northwest over moonlit realms, like a willow leaf on a huge, measurable pond. By mid-noon of the following day, Colonel Whipscut was back at Salamandastron, making his report to Lord Hightower after a fruitless search of the shoreline.
I lost them, sir.
Hightower's brows beetled low over his fierce dark eyes.
Lost them, Colonel? How in the name of scuttled stripes could you lose two young'uns carrying great heavy backpacks? Surely their trail must have been clear enough.
Whipscut shook his head, scratching his waxed moustache until it became like tattered string.
Well, had my breakfast as usual an hour after dawn, took a stroll down to the blinking beach, and there were the tracks plain as the ears on me bonds, what? Had followed them for only a short while, when they bloomin' well vanished.
Consoling his temper, the Badger Lord stared at his colonel.
Where exactly did you lose sight of the trail?
Whipscut gestured back over his shoulder.
Round those rocks at the North Spur, sir, where the tide washes over at flood. Not a sign of the scoundrels. I've got a search patrol north along the coast. They'll find the villains if any beast can. Did all I could, sir. Apologies.
Hightower placed a huge paw on his friend's shoulder.
No need for apologies, Whip. You did your best.
A knock sounded on the chamber door. Hightower called briskly.
Come.
Sergeant Widepaw, a fine, capable veteran hare, entered. With him was a runner, an extremely bright and pretty hare maid. Both saluted with their lances. Then Widepaw spoke, keeping his eyes to the front.
Colonel, sir, my lad, no sight of the runaways whatsoever. I did find this, however, on the North Spur, sir.
He produced a quadrant braided cord of red and green. The colonel inspected it, nodding.
Best Scarum's paw bracelet. Made it for him myself. What in the name of scutneers would that be doing there, what?
Sergeant Whitepaw nodded for the hare maid to step forward.
Sir, Mindle has something to say. Carry on, girl.
The hare maid runner bobbed a brief curtsy.
I was on afternoon second run yesterday, sir. Spotted a little sailboat near the North Spur. There was an otter on board. He didn't see me, sir, so I carried on. Thought nothing more about it, sir. He looked like most sea otters. Friendly type.
Lord Hightower and the colonel exchanged glances. The badger waited until Whipscut had dismissed both hares. When they had gone, the colonel banged a clenched paw on the tabletop.
Crover wave dog! I might have barely well known.
The hackles rose on Hightower's broad shoulders.
That pirate! How many times have I warned Sir Gaxus to stay away from him? Crover is naught but trouble. I wish I had that young sea otter in front of me now. I'd make that rudder of his sting. He wouldn't sit down for a season.
The realization of what has happened hit Whipscut.
Oh, lack a barely day and a half. They've run off to sea with him. No wonder I lost the confounded trail.
Hightower sat at the table, placing his striped head between both paws, his voice weary with resignation.
Better not breathe a word to Merola or Dunfrieda. No use worrying them further. Just say you lost the tracks over some rocks and shifting sands. I tell you, Whip, those two have really done it now.
The colonel twirled his moustache fiercely, tidying it up.
You're right, old friend. The worrying will be up to us from now on. What?
Chapter 4. Agarno, King of Riftguard, hated the sea. Just the smell of it could make him queasy. He loathed sailing and detested boats or ships of any kind. He had been this way even when he embarked on that final ill-fated voyage with his father, Sarengo. Agarno was quite content to rule his kingdom of fjords, mountains, pine forests and pebble beaches from the comforts of his father's throne. Only pure ferrets could rule Riftguard. Agarno was a true pure ferret, snow-white with pink glittering eyes. Slumping down on the purple cushions of his shell-ornamented throne, he glared out over his gross stomach, which extended right up to his many chins. A false leg, carved from the white bone of some great fish, clicked against the floor, a dreadful reminder of that last voyage. Agarno had been the only creature to make it back to Riftguard alive. The peace of his throne room was shattered when Prince Blad came hurtling in, yelling and wailing.
Dada, stop, Kurda! She come after me with the sword!
He scrambled behind the throne as Princess Kurda bounded in, swinging her sword. Agarno nodded swiftly to his rat guard. Six of them penned her in, grasping their spear hafts to form a barrier around the irate princess. Agarno glared at her.
Stop this fighting, you hear me, Kurda? Now, what do you want to say for yourself, eh?
The princess strode forward with the rat guard still penning her, but moving along with her as she went. She sighted her brother cowering behind the throne and pointed the sword at him.
Dad, fat toad, he been telling tales again, yar.
Her father's pink eyes continued glaring at her.
Tails! 3 barrels of herring is not tails. There's food, not practice for the sword playing. You no do that with food.
Kurda curled a contemptuous lip at her father and made some slashing motions in the air with her sword.
There be plenty more fishes in der sea.
Agarno stamped his carved bone paw irately on the floor.
Not if you keep chopping them up for sword practice, der vote. But I not called you two here to talk about that. Guards, leave us now. Blad, get out from behind that chair. Listen, I have something important to talk about with you both.
As the guards left, Captain Rifton strode in. Agarno eyed him quizzically.
Yeah, Rifton, what is it?
The captain saluted with his spear.
I've caught the creatures who are stealing the walkway, would your majesty? 3 of them, a squirrel, an otter, and an hedgehog. They was building an escape boat, stocking it up with victuals too. Turnips, carrots, and chopped herrings. What do you want doing with them? I've got all 3 locked up in the punishment cages.
Agarno snorted and shrugged moodily.
Why tell me all this? You're the captain. Do what you want. Don't bother me. A king have other things to do. Drown them!
Kurda interrupted.
No, I'll deal with them. Live prisoners are good for the sword practice, especially thieves and escapers.
Agarno shook his head, regarding his daughter with distaste.
Just like your grandfather. Yeah, you're a cruel one, Kurda. So be it. Save spoiling more barrels of herring, hey?
The king's stomach shook as he laughed at his little joke. Kurda pawed her sword edge with anticipation. Triss and her 2 friends shuddered with cold. The punishment cage was half submerged in the cold shallows of the fjord, which were fed by icy water from the mountains. Welfo the hogmaid laughed bitterly.
Brr, I can't stop my spikes from rattling.
Shogg the otter stared gloomily through the boards.
Your spikes will soon stop rattling for good, marm. Captain Riffin will see to that. It's a death sentence for us, mates. I'll wager anything on it.
Triss gritted through her chattering teeth.
Stop that kind of talk, Shogg. We're not dead yet. Let's see what we can do about breaking out of this cage. We've got nothing to lose now.
The rest of the slaves labouring on the walkway cast sympathetic glances at the three creatures in the punishment cage. A guard flicked his whip out across their backs.
Get working, you idle scum, unless you want to join your pals in the cage. Come on now, get that wood laid, straighten that ground. Keep those logs tight and even there, you lazy lot.
Badly fed and poorly clad, the slaves toiled on, unable to stop and remove long pine splinters from their paws or bandage scuffed, stone-scarred limbs with tufts of moss and grass. They were terrified to stop, lest they too end up in the dreaded cages, where they would face death from exposure or execution at the sadistic whim of Captain Rifton. Only when darkness fell were the workers allowed to halt in their chores. Whips cracked as they were led off to the slave quarters beneath Riftguard. There they would be fed on a single bowl of grain porridge, some vegetable roots, and a pail of water between every group of 10. Beneath the waning moon, cold night winds swept over the deserted worksite. Activity in the cage, which had begun furiously, had now slackened, owing to the intense cold eating into the bones of the three captives. They had groped around through the floor bars and collected rocks from the riverbed. First, they had tried wedging them between the bars to see if the metal could be bent enough for them to squeeze through. Then Shogg the otter, who was the strongest and most resistant to cold, battered away at the big, well-greased padlock on the door grill. Neither method proved successful. Their limbs were growing slower and stiffer as the night advanced. Welfo began to weep softly. Triss threw a paw about her shoulders and tried to comfort the hogmaid.
Hush now, friend. Don't cry. Keep your chin up. You wouldn't want to give those vermin the satisfaction of seeing your tears now, would you? We'll go down fighting to the last if we have to.
Shogg let his rock sink to the cage floor, whispering urgently,
Quiet, mates. Some beast's coming.
It was Flith, Captain Rifton's lieutenant. He stood watching them closely. Ceasing their activities, the three prisoners grasped the bars and stared dumbly back at the impassive rat. Flith poked his spear out and rattled the bars. He tested the padlock by prodding it.
Don't worry, you three. We won't let you freeze to death in there. We ain't that cold-hearted, aren't we, Edgepink?
Welfo wiped tears from her eyes, hopefully.
No, Lieutenant.
Flith leaned on his spear and chuckled.
Course we ain't. Not one of us Riftguard's rat is going to lay a paw on ye. Princess Kurda is, though. She's got something special planned for ye three. Good night and sleep well now, if you can.
Flith padded off, sniggering happily at his own joke. Triss felt her stomach turn over at the thought of Princess Kurda's unimaginable designs for their fate. No sooner had the lieutenant gone than another figure appeared from behind a stack of pine logs on the bank.
Triss! Miss Trissy! Are you all right?
The young squirrelmaid pushed her face to the bars, trying to keep the eagerness in her voice down.
Druffo, I kept hoping you'd come. Good old Druffo!
The aged squirrel waded into the water, holding an earthenware jug above his head. He brought it close to the bars, but it would not go through.
Come to the bars, Welfo! You do, Shogg. I'll hold this while you sup it. 'Tis some hot vegetable soup. We made out of bits of this and that. 'Tain't much, but it'll keep the life in ye.
Heads up, mouths open, they stood side by side, whilst Druffo shared the soup out, pouring it, still hot, straight into their mouths. It was meagre stuff, cobbled together with a few pawfuls of grain, turnip, carrot, and some wild onion. Triss had never tasted anything so delicious. They held their mouths open like young fledglings being fed by a mother bird until the last precious drop had gone.
Sorry, that's all I could manage for ye.
Druffo apologised. Triss felt new life coursing through her.
What's happening inside Riftguard? What have you heard, Druffo?
The old squirrel pulled himself to the riverside of the cage so that he could not be seen from the bank.
I followed Captain Rifton up to the throne room and got me ear close to the door. Good and close, Triss. Agarno was talking to Kurda and Blad and Rifton too. So here's the gist of it. We've got to get you out of this cage, one way or another, quick. Because instead of turnips, Kurda plans on using you three for her sword practice. I don't like to bring bad news, but that's how 'tis going to be.
Shogg began shaking the cage bars.
Then what are you waiting for, Drufo? Get us out of here now!
Welfo clasped Triss' paw anxiously.
But what'll we do then? They've probably smashed our escape boat up. We've got no food, no weapons, and no place to hide. Rig and the slave catcher will hunt us down. We'll be dragged back here for Kurda to slice us up with swords.
Triss had to stifle her friend's mouth with a paw before she started to get hysterical.
Hush now. I'm sure Drufo has a plan. Panicking will get us nowhere. You have got a plan, haven't you, Drufo?
The old squirrel bit his lip and shrugged.
It ain't much of an idea, but 'tis your only hope.
He fumbled an object through the bars to Triss. It was a file, rusted, broken and old, but a piece of rag where the handle once was.
I risked my life getting that. My old bones won't take this icy water much longer. But here's what you must do. Once you've filed through the bars, your only hope is to steal the king's new boat and sail away to some place they'll never find ye. I'm sorry I couldn't do more for ye, Trissy, but that's it.
You did all you could, old friend. We'll manage. Now get yourself out of this fjord and back inside before you freeze to death.
Drufo took her paw and clasped it fervently.
You're the model of your dad, missy. Good luck and fortune be with ye.
Chapter 5. Far from the Northlands and Riftguard, beyond the great seas, dew glinted off the leaves as a warm spring day dawned over Mossflower Wood. Bickle was still asleep, curled up beneath the beech trunk, covered by last autumn's dead leaves. Rugum, however, was up and about as the mole babe's confidence had returned with the advent of daylight and sunshine. He dug up coltsfoot roots and far more whortleberries and young dandelion buds. Trundling back to the fallen tree trunk, he wakened his little squirrel friend by tickling her nose with a stem of hedge mustard plant.
You're waking me up, girt dozy chaps. I finded breakfast.
Biggle rubbed her eyes with grubby paws, sat up and scratched her bushy tail.
I'm thirsty.
Rugum reached up and grabbed a low-hanging witch hazel branch. Shaking it, he drenched Biggle's head with dew, chortling.
You will have a good drink, my dearie.
Biggle seized another branch and sprinkled him back. They giggled and chuckled, splashing one another with dew and rolling in the dead leaves. The breakfast was not a roaring success. Biggle lost no time in telling her friend.
I'm still hungry. That not nice breakfast. Me like warm pasties and strawberry juice. When are us going back to the abbey?
Rugum lay on his back, gently kicking the witch hazel twigs and catching the water in his open mouth.
We am lasted. Dunno we way back to Habby. We spec they am come a-looking for us in afore long. Which a ways do ye think and red our bees, Bick?
The dibbin squirrel pointed with her tail.
West, north, east, that way, me think.
They set off in the direction she had indicated, neither of the two babes feeling very confident. But it was a warm, bright day, almost summer-like, and the anxiety they were causing did not occur to their infant minds. Along the way, they found other things to eat and a small stream where they drank their fill and had a good old paddle. Girdle Sprink had discarded his heavy apron and climbed the cellar stairs for the third time that morning, puffing and panting. The cellar hog made his way out into the orchard, where he sat down on an upturned wheelbarrow next to Malbin.
That's the fourth time I've searched those cellars of mine. Still not a whisker of those two rogues to be seen.
The healer recorder beat dust from her faded green habit.
I've been scouring the gatehouse since the crack of dawn without any luck whatsoever. Where can they be?
Ridiculous, the ancient shrew gatekeeper approached.
Move up there, Girdle. My old paws are weary from rooting round the dormitories, and me back is broken in 10 places from crawling round under beds. What a pair of pickles those dibbons are. Oh, there, Mem Flackery, anything new?
The fat hair nurse dug a few warm almond scones from her apron pocket and munched on them worriedly.
No, pray not, old lad. That rotten gooch won't jolly well let be such as kitchens any more. Cooks are like that, ain't they? Heard the abbot telling Skipper to round up his otters for a woodland search, though I can't think for the barely life of me how the little scoundrel slipped out, what?
Abbot Apodemus stood at the gate, calling advice to Skipper and his two stalwart young otters as they set off north up the path.
Find a stream if you can. See if there are any gowsim shrews about. They may have seen our dibbons.
Skipper waved his javelin in the air, acknowledging Apodemus.
Right you are, Father Abbot. Though whiffen shrews had found them, they'd probably brought them back here long since. It is worth a try, though. Now, don't fret yourself, mate. We'll find Ruggum and Bickle, if and they're out there. Go in, and keep those gates closed now.
The sunny day clouded slowly. It was late afternoon when the two little runaways decided they were even more lost than they had been. All around them, the silent vastness of Mossflower seemed to be closing in. Ruggum was making plans for the oncoming darkness.
Here, Bick, as in's bain't a-getting caught out in the open when it be's dark, burn name-arm. We'm look about for ye comfy little den and camp in there, all safe and cosy-like.
Bickle was forced to agree. She pointed off to the sky eastward.
Look at them clouds, might rain by dark.
Even though they were only dibbons, the tiny creatures had instinctive feelings about weather conditions. Wandering farther into the woodland, Ruggum held up a pudgy digging claw.
I'm thinking he be's right, Bick. Breeze is starting to move ye tree taps. Hasn't's best find ye good cover, boy yoki oi.
As often happens with springtide weather, the change was sudden. Low breezes gathered force, scurrying through the random rank trunks of oak, beech, alder, sycamore, elm and other forest giants. The tree canopy began swaying, creating a forceful rustling of twig, branch and leaf. Paw in paw, the two little ones ran through the gusting woods, afraid of being outside the abbey walls, which represented safety, peace and home. Late noontide darkened as lowering clouds graced to cloak the previously bright day. After an all too brief spit spot of damp, the rain came sweeping in, thick and heavy, driven by the gale, slanting through the leafy canopy and drenching the loamy ground. Breathless and fearful, the dibbons took temporary refuge against the massive trunk of an ancient spreading oak. Still clutching one another's paws, they stood with their backs against the rough bark. Ruggum cast an angry glance at the skies, resentful of the trick played on him by the elements. Bickle, scared out of her wits by the stormy event, began to whimper.
Me not like all of this. Oh, no, not one little bit.
Ruggum pulled her around to what appeared to be the lee side of the oak. She gave a sudden squeak.
Eek!
The dibbon mole blew a sigh of frustration.
What a matter now, marm? Bain't so windy this year aside.
Bickle turned to face the tree.
Little door with words on it, see?
It was a door, let into the broad oak trunk low down. Ruggum traced the word carved on it with his digging claw.
Well, you wonders what he word do say, Bick?
Bickle shrugged.
I don't know. Open a door if hers has got soaked and drowned.
Moss, soil and dead vegetation had built up under the door. Ruggum found a stout stick and levered at it whilst Bickle shoved hard. The door scrunched against the ground as it gave way, fraction by fraction, opening inward. Groaning rusty hinges popped free, and the whole thing heeled crazily. This left a space through which they could both enter. Some gowsim shrews who had been on their way to visit Redwall met up with Skipper and his two otters as they entered the fringes of Mossflower. Spiky-furred little creatures, with coloured headbands and short kilts, they all carried rapiers in their broad belts. Gowsim were known by the initials of their kind, Guerrilla Union of Shrews in Mossflower, and they were traditional friends and allies of Redwall Abbey. Their chieftain held the title Logalog. He was always the toughest and wisest of the shrews. Skipper saluted them cheerily, hugging the leader affectionately.
Ha ha ha! Logalog grew, you old stream wumper! You're just the lad we're looking for. I bring ye a message from the abbot.
Grew and his 20 shrews listened, Our skipper told them of the two lost Dibbons. They agreed to help with the search, one of them piping up from the back.
We'll find the little snips, and old Gooch the Cook will reward us with double helpings of everything. Yum, yum.
Logalog Grew cast a severe eye over the speaker.
I'll reward you with a pair of box steers, me laddo. We don't need no rewards for helping friends. That ain't the Gowsome way.
Skipper chuckled.
No offence, mate. I know what your pal meant. We'll all get double helpings if and we find the Dibbons. Come on.
They struck off into the woods and soon picked up a trail. Ruggum and Bickle stayed in the entranceway of the hole, from which an old flight of steps ran down into the darkness beyond. Neither felt brave enough to venture any further. They stood in the doorway where it was sheltered from the rain. Again, the little mole traced the lettering on the door. He was unable to read or write.
We wonder what this your place be called.
Bickle stared at the lettering, blinked and yawned. Sleep was beginning to overcome her. The word on the door was written thus, Brockhall. She pretended that she could read and translate it.
I can read words better than you, Rug. It say, hiding here from the rain.
Brr, you making it up.
No, I not.
Yes, you bees.
Bickle was tired and not prepared to continue the argument, so she changed the subject.
I wonder what down those steps.
The mole babe ventured to the top step and peered downward into the gloom.
Something shiny.
Bickle scoffed.
You'd not see something shiny down the steps.
Ruggum was a mole babe born to argue.
Oh, yes, I did.
Bickle sat down, leaning against the wall. She closed her eyes, not wanting to get into another debate with her stubborn friend.
Well, if it be nice and shiny, you go and get it for me.
Ruggum needed no second bidding. He was overcome with curiosity.
Right then, I'll go and get it to show he I speak true.
Nerving himself up, he descended the steps, hugging the side wall closely. Bickle dozed off, amid visions of cavern hole and a wonderful meal of hot plum pudding with creamy almond sauce and a beaker of strawberry cordial. She was very partial to anything but the flavour of strawberries. But she was instantly brought back to reality by the sound of a gruff mole shriek as Ruggum came out of the gloom like a dark furred cannonball. The shiny golden object gripped in one paw. He grabbed Bickle with his free paw and pulled her along, out into the rain and wind.
Oh, come on, quick, like!
Bickle dug her foot paws in, reluctant to be out in the weather. However, the look of shock and dumb terror on Ruggum's face and the fearful glance he shot over his shoulder at the dark hole behind them soon decided her. Wordlessly, she ran headlong beside him, out into the darkness of the storm-torn woodlands. Brambles snagged their smocks. Sodden shrubbery made them stumble. Rain beat in their faces. Both Dibbons fled as though a pack of foxes were after them.
Over here! I see them! There they go!
The strange, gruff-sounding voice sent them scurrying even faster, hearts pounding fearfully, sobbing for breath. Suddenly, they were seized in a grip of iron. Their tiny footpaws left the ground as they were whirled high into the air.
Ha! Gotcha, me little beauties!
Chapter 6. Skipper of Otters held the two limp figures close to him. Logalog Grew took a swift look at them, shaking his head reprovingly at the otter chieftain.
What were you thinking of, you great river dog? You've gone and scared the little ones right out of the senses. Pouncing on them like that, shame on you.
Skipper's face was such a picture of dismay that Logalog was forced to smile. He clapped his friend's back.
No real harm done, Skip. They're safe enough now. Let's get them back to Redwall. Mem Flackery and old Moundbill will soon have the rascals as right as rain.
Skipper covered the unconscious pair with his cloak.
Ain't nothing right about rain, matey. And don't tell Mem or Malbin this, or they'll have my rudder for rug strings.
Girdle Sprink and old Criculus were keeping watch on the northeast wall battlements. Peering out into the rain-swept night, they held the lanterns high. The Sellerhog was first to hear Skipper's powerful shout.
Ahoy, the abbey! Any beast home? We're coming in!
Criculus swung his lantern to and fro as Girdle yelled,
"Come in by the northeast wicker gate, skip me, old mate!"
Hurrying down the wall stairs, the gatekeeper and the cellar hog withdrew the bolts on a small gate in the centre of the rampart wall. He held up his lantern.
"Over here, Skip! There! I see you got some gowsome with ye! Welcome, friends! Get in here out of the weather. Well, well, you found the Dibbons good tracking pals."
Blankets were laid near the hearth in front of the fire at Cavern Hole. Abbot Appademus watched anxiously as Malbon Grimp tended to the little one's bruises and scratches. Skipper warmed his paws by the blaze.
"Grew spotted em east and a touch north in the woodlands. I'm surprised two babes could have gotten that far alone."
Mem Flackery held a small camphor vial under the Dibbons' noses. Screwing their faces, they coughed and whined as they began to come round. The hair nurse spoke without looking up.
"Ha! I'm never surprised at anything flippin' Dibbons can get up to, what? Especially these two fiends, what? I say, Gru, old lad, what's that thing you've got there?"
Logalog Gru passed the shining object over to the abbot.
"It fell from the mole babe's paw when Skipper picked him up. 'Tis heavy enough, I tell you."
Appademus inspected the object, holding it near to the firelight. It was bright yellow metal, a thick oblong band smooth to the touch. On either curve of the oblong, a jet-black stone twinkled. Sculpted at the centre of the band was a curious inset design. The good Father Abbot passed the stone on to Criculus.
"I can't make head nor tail of it. You take a look, old one."
Nodding his head, the ancient shrew gatekeeper spoke.
"'Tis a paw ring, meant to fit over the broadest part of some beast's paw. Oh, very nicely crafted, too, from the finest gold. You see these two black stones? They are true jet, rare, precious gems. But as for the markings on it, I'm afraid I haven't the slightest idea what they mean."
Rugerman Bickle was sufficiently recovered to sit up. They looked at their elders sheepishly.
Sirs, we am gotten lasted.
Bickle nodded vigorous agreement, then decided to blame Mem and Skipper. She pointed an accusing paw at them.
"You's locked a gate on us. We were shutted out. Us knock and knock, but no beast hear us. So we go for a walk in the woodsies."
The hair nurse muttered under her breath.
"Locked him out? Fibbing little wretches, what?
Formal Erm, the traditional leader of all Redwall moles, came trembling in.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.